So we are starting with this next talk, which is GPU accelerated high performance computing primer. The talk will be given by Ashwin Ashok and G. Raja Suman. So both are here. Can we have a round of applause for them? I'm particularly interested in this talk because I think it got the highest number of votes when it was on funnel at PyCon. So Ashwin Ashok is a student at Vignan and he's interested in open source and embedded systems. Whereas G. Raja Suman, he works at TCS and is fond of embedded C and Python. So just enjoy the talk.
Hello?
Okay.
So I'm audible to everybody, right? Okay, so before I start anything, I'll make one thing clear. If anybody has done CUDA programming or OpenCL programming before, please raise your hands up. You can sleep. Okay, because there's nothing new I'm bringing to the plate here, but what we are trying to do is try to bring awareness, because everybody is like, if I want to process something, I'll put it in that power, that system is really powerful, I'll just shift it there. No. If you buy an NVIDIA GPU or if you buy an AMD GPU, you can do a lot of stuff faster than servers can do stuff. So you have lots of power in your hand, and I want to make sure that everybody knows. I won't bore you with my APIs, I won't bore you with my functions, I won't bore you with anything. All I want to say right now is, if you want to do stuff faster and if your algorithms are parallel or can be made parallel, you'll have amazing speed up. So, and the other thing I just want to say is, most of the stuff which I wanted to cover was already covered in Medusa. Like most of you guys were there in Medusa talk, right? Okay, so it was a nice super talk. So most of the stuff was covered there, and I hope some of you have observed, like whenever he went like this, can you see? It says for my system it says GCC, but for the Medusa talk it says LLVM. Okay, that'll make all the difference in this talk. Okay? Have anybody observed that? Okay, that'll make all the difference. So, GPU accelerated HPC problem. I just made this up, okay? I just wanted to pull some crowd out, so I just made this up. So, the end of an era. So, by the time Pentium chips were coming into the market, it didn't make any difference. Like 5 years ago, I had a 2 gigahertz processor. I still have a 2 gigahertz laptop. That didn't change. But the only transistor count increased. But this has nothing to do with performance. I'm just plotting a graph between clock speed and transistor count. So basically, what I'm saying is, even though manufacturers are putting more transistors into CPUs, the performance gains are only like marginal, like 1%, 2%. So, if you want to do anything, like if you want to increase the performance of your process, you need to do some tweaks, like transistor level tweaks. I won't bore you. I'm an electronics guy. I won't bore you. So, when you do that, when you increase clock frequencies, your power dissipation goes up. So, with great power comes great responsibility. With great clock speed comes great power consumption. Remember that. So let's go too fast, too parallel. So what is parallel? Everybody knows parallel. So I don't have to explain. If you know multithreading, you know parallel stuff. But this parallel is a new level of thinking. It's highly rewarding and challenging. And the hardware is already there. You don't have to buy new hardware. It's already there. If you play games, it's already there. So I shamelessly copied this from the Go programming language slides. So I'm just telling, if one guy can do a job in 10 days, 10 guys can do a job in one day. That's all I'm going to talk today. So, race to Minicore Mountain. Since the Pentium fiasco, your clock speeds are not increasing, like Pentium was like, Intel was like, you know what, let me put another guy, let three guys do the job, let four guys do the job. And so, you know, AMD, whatever Intel does, they just copy, so. Okay, is the other way around? It doesn't matter. So, they just did the same thing. They just changed where the CPU cores were, and they called it a new processor, whatever. So, it's not really a new concept. This concept is not really new. Back in, I'm an electronics guy, right? So I deal with this shit every day, I'm sorry. Crap every day. So, back in 1970 and 1980s, when these chips first came out, people had to do floating, that's when IEEE floating point specifications came out. So, these 8086 processors can't do floating point math without a floating point unit. How many of you guys have had to deal with IA32 assembly? Awesome. Oh, you are, dude, you are. So what happened was, okay, nothing happened. So these guys used another chip called 8087 and offloaded the floating point part there. So basically, what Intel is doing is, just copying what it did back in 1970 and 1980s. It's just bringing up Xeon 5 coprocessors, which have 61 cores. So more people gets a job in. So, have a laugh. So, everybody got the joke? Doesn't matter. So, world's first open science supercomputer. It has 18,688 nodes. And each node has 16 core Opterons. Now, this makes sense. Since I was telling more people, less number of time, that makes sense. But why the NVIDIA? Like, you should be asking, hey, dude, that K20 chip like cost like crap load of money. Why put that? Because that is where the magic takes place. The AMD chip does nothing. It only does memory transfers and stuff. So in most of the major supercomputers right now, the GPUs do the magic. So why use GPU? Please read the slide. Explain. So why use GPU for computing? One thing, CPUs are hitting the wall. Like, most of the CPUs are, like, even if you wait for 5 years and buy a new CPU, it doesn't matter. It'll still be like 2.3 gigahertz, 32 core. It won't matter. But, and also, like, development of parallel algorithms is taking place. Since the last 15 years, we've seen, I was a small kid back in 15 years, so I'm just saying, we've seen a lot of parallel algorithms come up. And extremely powerful hardware. That's cropping up, and it's not really a new idea. I know NVIDIA has a bad name in the open source community, but this is one thing they're doing it right. CUDA, they're doing this thing right. Why? Because, simple, when you say that four cores do the job in less time, what happens when you put 240 cores? So NVIDIA is just going like, I'll just keep on putting cores. It's a good thing. And I don't use Apple products, but I have to give this one to Apple. They're the one who started the OpenCL stuff. So what the OpenCL stuff does is really interesting. So there, first of all, if you want to increase your performance, like for a program, if you want to increase the performance, there are four ways. First is you can put multiple CPUs, or you can use OpenMP, hash pragma OMP before the for loop, and boom. And you can use GPUs. Or, like 5 years, 7 years ago when CUDA was not there, people used to fool OpenGL into thinking it was doing math. So that's really complicated stuff. So what OpenCL, what Apple did was, it made a common C99 programming language for all these. That's OpenCL. Next. So I know you guys are talking, hey, this is PyCon, this guy is not talking about Python. Fine, it'll come. So where is the embedded here? We're in the embedded segment, right? I'm an electronics guy. I want stuff to get smaller, not bigger. So we are not doing anything with Intel now. We replaced Intel with ARM. The CPU is only doing the memory transfers, right? It's just doing malloc and control stuff. Why do you need Intel to do that? ARM can do that. And I put, and I didn't put, NVIDIA guys are doing it, I'm just saying. So NVIDIA guys put a powerful GPU and coupled it with ARM. And that thing, it's called the Jetson toolkit. It can beat like my laptop with Intel. So it has 300 crores or something. I'm just saying, those kind of chips are coming to the market right now. Tegra chips are hitting the market, so those are insanely fast. Am I supposed to do after this, right? Okay. So AMD is bringing 5 GHz, 6 GHz stuff. I already told you, with great clock frequency comes great power consumption. If you want to pay the bills, you pay. So CPU architecture is more about how fast can I do a single work, single task. Latency. CPU is all about latency. How fast can I do a single work? But GPU is more like, how many tasks can I do? Everybody getting the difference? CPU, 5 GHz, how fast can I do a single task? GPU is like, how many throughput? That's why they don't have 16 cores, they have like hundreds of cores on SMD cores. Now this guy will take over. Hello.
Yes. So let's see what we intend to do with our GPU. Basically, we have our application code, which we may consider as consisting of some sequential code, something like if the data is dependent on a previous input or something such kind of sequential stuff. Let the CPU handle it. I'm not going to touch these kind of things, and let the CPU itself handle it. But I have some kind of code, something like computationally intensive functions. What this program intends to do is switch these contexts into a GPU and thus increase the throughput. And now, why do we need to use Python for GPU? Well, it's simple. We do know about the Zen of Python. It always tells us keep it simple, keep it simple. So what GPUs are, they are everything that scripting languages are not. They are highly parallel, and thus what we intend to do is shift all the work which are highly parallel to a GPU, and leave the rest of the things with the CPU itself. Thus you could see that CPUs are largely restricted to control, and as Ashwin said, CPU always depends on how many tasks I perform per second, whereas GPU deals with how much amount of tasks do I perform. So if you integrate Python and CUDA in order to do this kind of stuff, we can do it with PyCUDA, as well as we have something called as OpenCL. And let's see what PyCUDA is. Okay, PyCUDA was is a baby of Andreas Kolesker. He mainly developed this thing because he was a great programmer. He was probably interested in this, and he wanted to do and achieve his stuff much more simpler. So what you could see that we have a kernel function which we need to implement on the GPU, and this kernel is queued as C, but sometimes it is not. We could totally perform the kernel function into Python, but sometimes we need to make a compromise, and let's see why we need to make that. You see, this is the basic flow of the CPU stuff on Python. Like, you edit it, you compile it, you link it, and then you run it. That's for the CPU stuff. But for the GPU stuff, you need to specify the code, which you need to specify some stuff that this part belongs to the GPU and this part belongs to the CPU. And so here we just move on to something else. Over here we have something called as a source module, and this uses an LLVM and PTX. It has a PTX, and then we have our stuff to be implemented on a GPU. But you see the box over here? That whole box is of the PyCuda, and we needn't literally do anything. PyCuda takes care of all our stuff over here. So again, so Python, it follows the Zen of Python, makes our task simple rather than following the blatant C code, which you need to, if you follow the C code, you need to follow all these things. So Python. Yeah, you could read that. That's a pun kept by my brother. So let us go about the setup and demonstration of PyCuda. How a lot of queries have been pouring in on how to set up this stuff and how to use PyCuda. So setting up the environment requires you. Suppose you are using a laptop with NVIDIA GPU. You need to install its drivers first, in the first place, and then you need to import some basic stuff before starting your code. You need to import the PyCuda driver, some tools, and the auto init. And then we have the heart of our GPU programming. It is called the kernel, and in order to write the kernel, this kernel is essentially to say that this part of the program belongs to the GPU and it must be executed by the GPU. Thus, we use the prefix underscore underscore global underscore underscore. This tells us that this is a C function, and this prefix tells the compiler to generate the GPU code and not the CPU code while compiling it. And inside this kernel function, what we have is our code, and it also has a return type and the function name, along with a few arguments. Let's see how this thing will look. Like, what do we mainly intend to do with the threads is that we have some computationally intensive stuff. Like, suppose we have a for loop and we need to do some iterative operation like 128 times. What my kernel does is, instead of performing the 128 operations on a single processor, I make multiple threads and I perform the 128 operations on this, on the whole 128 threads of the GPU, and thereby reducing my time, reducing the time taken in order to implement this stuff. But this is a Python conference, but please bear with us. You need to know some of these stuff before starting or diving into PyCuda. We have the concept of blocks as well as threads and grids. Like, you could see that block is essentially a group of threads, and a grid is a group of blocks. This concept will be very useful for performing stuff like image processing and such kind of stuff like 2D processing, 3D processing. And so here is a basic example of how our kernel would look like. You see that here, consider the example of having a for loop and having to perform a multiplication operation using that for loop. So what we are here doing is we are using a thread. This is a structure, and we are taking that 128 loops and giving it individually to one single thread, and thereby we are reducing the number of steps taken. Yep. Oh. Well, you could see that this is how a simple kernel function would look like. And let's go and move on to some bigger examples on image processing as well as signal processing. Ashwin, what do you like?
Hello, can you hear me? Okay, so actually sorry Anya, I asked them to drop certain slides because you guys are already bored. You've seen too much code already. Is it not? Let's be frank. So I thought why not show you some demonstrations. And again, I don't want to show you big things. I just want to show you small things and show that you can do it. I don't want to show you big things. You can write this. You can do this. Okay. So. Okay. Anybody can see my code, right? Okay. View presentation, right? Okay. It's bigger, right? So, what this program does is the simplest PyQDA program ever. So what this thing does is simply takes two arrays and multiplies them element wise. Just takes two arrays and multiplies them element wise. That's all it does. Okay. And I'm taking exactly 2^16. Is it 2^16? Yeah, 2^16 elements. So I'm taking two arrays of 2^16 elements and multiplying them each. And then I'm benchmarking. Like, it's not even benchmarking. I'm just seeing CPU, how much time is taken for the CPU and how much time is taken for the GPU. Let's see. So,
jeez, that's a goof up.
Okay, it's not a goof up. My laptop fell. So, you can see CPU time was like 7. This is floating, right? So it's 0.0007 something. And the GPU time was like 0.11, and I'm here promising you that GPU is fast. What actually happened in the background was, you see, the GPU code has to be compiled. And this compilation takes place, like, one of them wanted to know how this compilation takes place. NVIDIA is not telling us, but what I know is there's a language called PTX, just like there's assembly for Intel. There is PTX for the GPU. So they use the LLVM architecture to kind of compile this C99 code into the PTX. That's what happens in the background. That is what's slowing this thing down. So if I take 2^32 elements, this delay won't matter, because that time CPU will be lagging far behind. We'll see that. So let me take this program with add.py. It's basically the same code as before. What all I'm doing is, even if you can't see it, doesn't matter. All I'm doing is I'm repeating the experiment. I'm repeating the experiment over and over again. And each time I'm repeating the experiment, I'm increasing the number of elements by a factor of 2. Got me? I'm repeating the experiment 28 times, and every time I do that experiment, I'm increasing the number of elements in the array by a factor of 2. Okay? So I So I run it.
Okay. So
awesome. The CPU thing was slowing it down. What happened here was, and I can zoom. I'll zoom. What happened here was, can you guys see the difference? See, like when I had 2 power 1 elements, when I had 2 power 2 elements, when I had 2 power 3 elements and 2 power 4 elements and so on, the GPU was actually slower. Anybody got me? The GPU was slower, why? And you see the delay is consistent because, and that delay is the time taken to compile the PTX code. But once I hit a number like 2 power 20, 2 power 21, so you decide which is faster. So basically, if your CUDA programs are slow, it is because you are either not keeping the GPU busy enough or you are giving a very small number. It takes an array of 2 power 64 size to actually kick the GPU out of slumber. Okay. So, and this is how the graph, this is a graph between GPU time versus CPU time. So as you can see, as my element size increases, it's actually performing faster, and this is, I think this is exponential scale. Okay. And let me show you another program. What should I show? Julia. Anybody into fractals? Anybody? Ladies here, chudivar patterns, stuff. So fractals are self-repeating stuff, okay? You take a triangle, and on each side of a triangle, you put another triangle. On each side of that thing, you put another triangle, you keep on doing it, you get a fractal. Okay? And fractal antennas are electronics. So, if you want to do a fractal on a pure Python implementation, it's real slow. It's as slow as finding the Fibonacci number of 340. It's that slow. But GPU is real fast. And this fractal has a dimension of 2560 by 2560. It's just fast. I dare you to do this on pure Python or even PyPy. You can't get this speed. I dare you. So, and I told you, I promised you self-repeating stuff, right? So, I zoom this part, same thing. Zoom this part, same thing. So, and I promised you stuff in like signal processing and signal processing and image processing. So, this is another example I have. So actually, I have a color image on my hard drive. It has RGB to gray. It's a very simple algorithm, but it's fast. It's just fast. I mean, you can't you won't know it's fast. You won't notice it's fast, but the file size is really huge. The file size is really huge. So, and again, this is, can you observe the difference? Can you observe the difference? The other one is blurred, right? So this is this is a simple image processing application in PyCUDA, where you just blur the image. Now, is this a filter? So
filter applied
on stuff. So I actually wanted to do something so much more, but you guys are bored and tired, but I don't want to tire you any longer, but there's lot of stuff you can do in PyCUDA. Many times faster. Faster than Spark, faster than Medusa, faster than any other thing can run. Only thing is, you have to learn how to use PyCUDA, and you know, writing this thing is a pain in the. So what we do, what Andreas Klotner is trying to do is try to create a Pythonic wrapper. But I'll tell you what's the problem with wrappers, and the problem with being lazy is. Monte Carlo. Anybody heard of Monte Carlo methods? You heard of Monte Carlo methods. Fine. Awesome. So what we do in Monte Carlo methods is we simply keep doing the experiment again and again and again and again until we arrive at a result. We just keep doing it again and again. So in this example, I'm calculating the value of pi. It'll take some time. Take some time. Tea break, anybody? So I deliberately put this last. Okay. So there is something you should observe here. GPU took 19 seconds. GPU took 19 seconds and CPU took like 0.06 seconds. Why? Why did GPU fail here? Why did GPU fail? It failed because I was using wrappers. You see this stuff? I didn't write C code like before, right? I didn't write C code like before. I used something that calls another C code. When that happens, lot of memory transfers takes place. When you have lot of memory transfer, it will only slow the program down. So if you want to test if your thing works on GPU, you can use wrapper. But if you want more speed and stuff, you need to go for pure C. Okay? Q&A session. Any doubts? Okay, so just be careful while writing kernels. Any doubts? No doubts?
Did we bore you?
I'm sure we bored you, but which one, sir? This one.
Retracing.
Is it doing ray tracing process?
I'm not doing ray tracing, I'm just calculating the value of pi.
Okay.
Oh, fine. Okay. You guys have time to listen to more of my crap?
Yeah.
Okay. So, I didn't really tell you what formula I was using to calculate pi, right? I didn't tell you that. All I did was I put a circle inside a square and I started throwing stones. And then I counted how many stones were inside the circle, and then I counted the total number of stones, and the ratio happens to be pi by 4, because the ratio between area of circle and square is pi by 4, right? Simple. Happy? Okay, there is one last thing that I'm not telling you, but which I want to tell you. You guys have been very patient with me, so I'm showing you this. So people are asking, do I do ray tracing, do I do stuff, what kind of stuff I do with PyCuda? So this is the simplest 3D example I have. Okay, everybody awake? This is the simplest 3D example I have. What I'm doing is I'm again trying to calculate the value of pi by putting a sphere inside a cube. That's all I'm trying to do. And I'm trying to represent this process as in graphics. So, and what is the source code is this is small, pretty small code. I don't want to scare you with 100 lines of code. Small piece of code, and I'm heavily relying on Qt libraries. Qt does most of the GUI work and drawing stuff. And the other awesome thing is there are not one but two GPUs in use right now. Do you get me? There are not one but two GPUs in use right now. So my laptop is an Optimus laptop. So it has Intel CPU an Intel GPU and an NVIDIA GPU. So all what my, so whatever my NVIDIA GPU does is simply calculate. My Intel CPU, my Intel GPU draws stuff on the screen, and my CPU, it just coordinates the memory transfers. So that the, so it takes some time to get over, but once you understand, it's easy. So basically, this talk is all about primer, a starting point. Anybody can do CUDA. Everybody should do CUDA if they want to faster code. If your code allows it. Okay? I'm done. Any doubts?
He has a query.
Yeah. You can switch on your mic. It's on GitHub.
We put it on GitHub.
It's on funnel.
You could refer our funnel and
One misconception I want to clear. We don't write a lot of code. We don't put a lot of code in JIT. But we put a lot of code in hard drive. So don't expect that code.
So this is a follow-up question to the question you asked after the Spark talk. I'm over here.
Yeah. Okay.
So you were like asking him if it was possible to use GPU computing for Spark.
I was.
Yeah, but the whole idea of Spark is it's everything is done in memory. You just throw gigabytes of RAM at your problem. But that is not really possible with a GPU, right? Because if you're dealing with a GPU and a CPU setup in a massively parallel framework, your main bottleneck is going to be memory transfers between the CPU and GPU.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
So that is at least my understanding. So how exactly do you think that something like Spark can be done using GPUs?
Like Andreas Klöckner is trying to do here. With my Monte Carlo stuff. I mean, this is not optimized. See, he's calling functions like this, pyqda.qmath, can you guys see? He's trying to call functions like this. I'm trying to do something similar, like if Spark can allow it. Like Spark had ML functions, right? Machine learning functions. Machine learning functions are, basically some of them are parallel in nature. Autoregressive methods, TVAR, NVAR methods, they're actually parallel in nature. So I was thinking, like, Spark was, all the Spark person was talking about parallel stuff, so why can't some of the code might be offloaded to CUDA or OpenCL. OpenCL is much more liberal when it comes to stuff like this.
All we want to say is that just put the stuff which the CPU is good at with itself. Don't throw it at the GPU. But if you find something in your code that the GPU can do, like something parallel stuff, something really parallel stuff which you can eliminate, move it on to the GPU. Like, that's what we want to see.
Lot of map reduce stuff can be done on GPU. That's really fast. Map reduce is really fast on GPU. Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just a second. I was a little confused on your last line when you said two GPUs were being used. That is same for all the processes where you were doing using GPU, right?
No.
Maybe. Because
it's
I
a likely scenario, right?
Huh?
It's a likely scenario.
We'll see. See. When I say LSPCI here, it shows both Intel and NVIDIA. But when I do LSMod, the NVIDIA driver doesn't show up. But when I do LSMod, while the program is taking place, only a...
So that...
I think both of them are running at the same time. See, NVIDIA doesn't talk about what happens in the background. That's the problem with them. AMD is really liberal with their code. So if you want to know what happens with AMD, you'll know. But what happens with NVIDIA, even I don't know. Nobody knows.
Okay, thank you.
Questions?
Oh, lot of
time. Hey, before, don't be hard on me, I'm not a CSE guy.
No, just one question, are you running Bumblebee? You said you was an Optimus laptop, right?
Yep,
so
yep. Bumblebee.
So the last time I checked Bumblebee, it was a pain to get NVIDIA and CUDA to work together. So has the situation improved?
Not quite. You know, I'm using,
Yeah, one.
Yeah, I'll show you. What is? Okay, I'm trying to increase the screen, but can you read the font over there? I'm using Manjaro, I'm not using Ubuntu. Like if I use Ubuntu, Fedora and all these mainstream distros, you know, the problem with the open source community, I mean, I don't have a problem. They have egos this big. They have egos this big. Like, no, this is OpenDriver. I want an open system with open drivers. Here, you don't know how the hardware works. How can you design a damn driver? So, leave the stuff to the professionals. You can't do drivers, don't try them. Let NVIDIA handle the battery work. But Ubuntu is trying to do, like, my driver, my display server, my drive, my stuff. Doesn't work out. If you want to do PyCura on Linux, please use Arch or Manjaro or any other Slackware, stuff like that. Non-stream distros.
So,
one last question.
Yeah.
So, PyCura, the examples only contain C code that is being wrapped and executed on the GPU, right?
C code is not being wrapped.
Okay.
Here.
Oh, fine. I have some problems.
With, basically, in every PyCura example, there's I've only looked at the examples, by the way. So, there's always a sizable amount of C code there.
There are some Cura programs which are absolutely no amount of C code, but C code is running in the background. Function is calling it.
So it is possible to escape, avoid writing C code, and still have to make things run on the GPU with the
You don't want to write C code at all, right?
Yeah.
You can see NVIDIA teamed up with Continuum Analytics.
Of course, yeah.
And they're trying to bring a NumbaPro accelerate. I heard that's what it called it. NumbaPro accelerate. They're trying to
NumbaPro is it going to be free?
No, you need, like, I took an academic license from my HOD sir in college, but it's not free. It's really costly.
Numba itself doesn't have that functionality. It's only NumbaPro which is not free, right?
Numba is like open source. I can do sudo apt
Numba. No, Numba is, but the NumbaPro which has this feature, GPU acceleration built in for Numba.
And even that is half, but it's because, sorry, NumbaPro's implementation of GPU, you still need to have a knowledge of threads, blocks and stuff. There was 2 years ago, my memory is fading, but 2 years ago, there was this project called Copperhead. There was a layer.
Yeah.
It really resembles STL.
Yeah.
So
still there, yeah.
So you can do, like, Copperhead allowed us to pure putting a decorator, right? That is not being maintained.
Okay.
I don't know why. So
Tiaro is not being maintained or Copperhead is not being maintained?
Copperhead is not being maintained.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Yes.
Any other doubts? Wait, can you put your hands up? That game? Oh. Which game? Oh.
Yeah, hey. It was my understanding last time I checked that the consumer level GPUs only run single precision calculations. Is that still true?
No. See, the CUDA, I'm not so sure about OpenCL, but with CUDA, they have this compute number, right? Compute 1.0. Like, compute 3.0 supports double precision, I believe. You check. I run a real crappy old GPU, so you check. My thing is like 4 years old, so.
Okay, so we would just wrap this up. So give a round of applause for them. I guess you people are interested in that, so if you want to catch him, you can catch him afterward, because we have got a session here right now, and a pretty interesting one. So.